going. Low impact and full body toning is our class designation today. So you will need perhaps your ball, if you have a hula hoop, if you have a jump rope, if you have a step, any of these things that might help you feel like you're able to increase your aerobic state, okay? To start right off, let's just march our feet. And in the event you wanted to put music on, so you have something that inspires you, I haven't talked about the whole music component for a while, but in your most ideal tempo, you can do a search for music that beats at 126 beats per minute, which is just fast enough that it's a little bit faster than what your body wants to move at, but it's not like this, right? So my body is so used to working at 126 beats per minute that that's pretty much what this is. So I don't use music. I use music when I'm doing my own practice, but in an environment like this, for us, I don't have it on. And interestingly enough, with what you all have told me about how this mic just really takes any extra noise out of the equation, I probably could play music and you wouldn't hear it. So I don't know if I'll consider that or not. The music aspect doesn't, the music interferes with my thoughts. So I listen to music when I generally don't have to speak, because when I speak, I got a whole bunch of stuff rolling around in my head. So can we go into a rock step? And what I want to get started right off with is an alternating leg rock step. So when you pull back into your step, go back to your marching feet right now. March feet. Take the other leg, forward rock step. You did about 8 steps on the first leg. So here we go. Most people struggle with transitions, right? You have to know where your step needs to stop and where the next move needs to begin. So in my book, you've completed the step on the back end of the step. So next time you step back, back to marching feet. March, march, take one leg, rock step, do 5. Your count's on the back, and that will help you know that that's the end of your step. There's 3. There's 4, marching feet, other leg, rock step for 5. There's 1. See how easy it is? 2. We're already doing neuroplasticity work. 3, 4, marching feet, 1, 2, 3, rock step, 3 of them. 2, marching feet for 3, 1, 2, 3, 3 rock steps. There's 1. There's 2, marching feet, right? Rock, marching feet, rock, marching feet. Are you with me now? Because if I was to count it out, it's 1 rock step to 3 marching feet, right? 1, 2, 3, rock step, march, 2, 3, rock step. Now, imagine how long as an instructor it's taken me to be able to not count my steps, or I should say count my steps, in addition to be able to having a conversation. That, my friend, is the challenge. Do you have to stay squared up? Absolutely not. This is the same number of steps. We are now just putting change of direction. So hopefully I've not thrown you off, but I personally feel like it's a little bit more challenging to add this nice wide lateral movement, and you have your foundation move, which is rock step marching feet, rock step marching feet. And then the more ground you want to cover, right, you just have to take your foot stride, increase the length Let that front leg receive that step. It's a gentle little push back. And if your knees protest, then you tighten up your foot position. And you have very little shifting. But why is it so hard to group movements, change direction, process it all? Because it's a feeling, right? And for people who struggle with rhythm and pattern, you're probably wanting to walk away and just sit down, right? And now, after this next rock step, go into your march, stay in march, right? Okay, so you're going to do an alternating leg tap out, but the march is still going to be your constant. So you're going to give me one tap out, march, one, two, three. You see the pattern? The three count center march is your transition base. And when you remember that for our purposes right now, it will help you just go, okay, every now and again, I'm going to tap a foot out, right? Because this right here can get into so much more movement. Again, change your pattern in that you're just going to rotate the hips, right? A little quarter turn, push, tap, 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 push, march, 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 push. Now, the more you press that leg out, the further it gets from your anchor leg, it's almost like you've got to quickly come back into your march. Push, right? So if you're just tapping, it's nice and easy. You do not have to rotate your hips. For anybody who's struggling with knee issues and you can't do torque, then you're not going to do the swivel of the hips. You're just going to tap out. But if you want more, push. Do we have to have the center march with this one? The center march actually makes this movement a little bit more complicated. So give me two more with the center march, and then we're going to omit the center march, right? Now, only the pushes. So again, no torque on the knee would be just static state right here through the midline with your little leg tapping out. If your body's like, I can do more, then you expand through this range, right? Does your arm need to sweep? No, you can still have more power, right? If you just use your legs. But if you want to feel your whole body engage, what am I doing with my arm? It's not a lazy, limp elbowed arm. I've got this open posture, right? Swish. It's like I'm wiping the counter off, right? And it's a pull. It's a pulling or a swishing forward, push, push. And the other arm tucks right behind the back. Now, if your shoulders are like going a little crabby, let the arms hang low. Why don't we all go to there for four more? Four, three. You're not going to keep rotating, okay? Pick one side, repeat, push. So what if you're not in a rotated movement and you're doing the squared up front back push? Unless your knees tell you to not torque on them, pivot your body a little bit, right? Because the angle is different. It doesn't seem like this would be any different than this, but it is, right? Push now. Stabilize over the top of that front leg. Give me, so all I mean by that is instead of you allowing this striding leg to load on the back end, you're going to take some of the forward and back movement out. You're going to hold steady so that your front leg has to do a little more work. Five, four, three, get ready. Two, alternate sides. Come through the middle, push. Ready. Allow your body to swivel around to the other side. Once you get over there, stay, right? How much heavy load are you putting into the leg that's push-pulling? This is a little unchecked body line. You're like, what? It looks like I'm doing exactly what you're doing. I'm showing you wrong. Stay over your front leg. you're in a partial squat. And even if you weren't in a partial squat because your knee doesn't want to be flexed, then you stand tall and you pull that leg up. But if you can do more, try not to load on that back leg. There's a lot required of your body to stabilize over your front leg. As you're looking down over your front leg, where is your knee in relation to the toes? Has the ankle collapsed? Is the arch pressed firm to the floor? Is the knee slicing to the center? That none of that's good. Push that knee to the outside. 4, 3, 2 marching feet. It doesn't take long to get your heart rate up. And if you don't have your heart rate, what feels like a little bit higher than when we first started, you're probably not getting the benefit of your aerobic conditioning. What does the word aerobic mean? With air, we are trying to oxygenate our system, increase the circulation, move the blood through your body at a faster rate, make your lungs have to actually expand more, greater than in the normal part of your day, knee lifts. So, why is that important? All of the inner workings of your body need some attention. We need to be able to have our heart respond to demand. When we're trying to get it to respond from a higher intensity, and then when you bring the intensity out of your movement, your heart should also recognize, oh, the demand is no longer there, so I can bring the beat back down to a comfortable level. A lot of people have no sensation of what it is to get into a recovered state. So for today, and as we go forward, I'm gonna just turn to the side to show you some sloppy action here, right? As you move through your days and weeks with me, if you never feel your heart rate rise, right? You're missing out on a huge component of your cardiovascular conditioning. Uh-oh, here we go. Push, pull, back. Push, pull, back. Push, pull, back. So this is kind of slow motion because I want you to try to get the pull back. It almost looks like I just did personally slow motion, right? It looks like I've slowed the video down, right? And that I'm like using a control to slow my action down. So much work has to happen for you to be in like good clean line and extension. And your lift might not be all the way up parallel to the floor, right? But whatever leg height you're pulling your knee up to, I want you to try to focus on extending, push, extending, right? And when you extend, the movement hasn't come to a completed state yet. You extend, pull back, set down, up, kick, pull, touch, up, kick. Your body needs to stay really like amped up. Full extension, shoulders out of the ears. This is hard. For the moments that you're standing on single leg stance, that is balance. So now, front kick, pause, back kick, touchdown. So you're going to have this repeating push, push, push. And now your body has to have some leveraging. So again, don't go weak kick here, but do be prepared to lean forward and lean back so that you can get your front kick. push, push, push. It's still a four-part leg chambering, okay? If I could count it fast enough without having to slow myself down even more. One, two, three, four. One, two, three, four. Up, kick, bend, set. Up, kick, bend, set. Two more. Push, push. Now, step touch. Remember which leg you had going forward. Ready? Marching feet. Get ready. Little kick. Little push, front kick, back push. When you push the back leg, be prepared to tip the body forward, tighten up the derriere, which is a lot to do. This little bit of a forward rock can often make you feel like everything has just gone wonky and you don't have control. So if your elbows are bent, right? And your body is in that forward collapsed position, that means you're probably not getting your leg drive back, forward, back, forward, back. You've got about eight of these, eight more. Push, and I'm just moving, right? I don't have to stay in one spot. Push. What I am doing, like this imaginary opponent, right, is in front of me, and I'm trying to body push them away with my front leg. And then there's a second person. I'm like in attack mode. The other person, bam. So turn your head, look back, push back, look forward, kick, look back, push. One more. Heel drive, push back, heel drive, release and relax. Your rear kicks with the turning of the head, I hope gave you a little bit of a challenge. Take one leg. This is your moving slide. Push, pull back. I actually have it is a slide and it's about 10 feet long. So if I brought it in, and maybe I will next week, it's about 2.5 feet wide and 10 feet long. And almost every one of my personal training clients over the years has been on it, even if they're not conditioning for skiing. So it's a lateral trainer that you put these little booties on over your shoes. And so your foot doesn't actually have to pick up off the trainer. You glide and you pull and you glide and you pull. But with our rug, or whatever floor you're on, you can't really do that. So it is a great way to strengthen some muscles that tend to be weak, right? Hold your push out. One leg is straight, one leg is bent. What's your bent leg doing? Look at it. Go, why is my bent leg always collapsed? Because you have a weakness in the outer portion of your hip. So what I want you to do is I want you to take this knee on the bent leg side and you're going to let it float in so long as you don't have pain. And then I want you to take it and push it out. So maybe you've heard the word clamshell. It is a particular range of motion for hip strengthening. Open out, stay out, push. Don't let that knee collapse. Now, when you push to the side, I really do want it to be a side push. So look at your feet. If you had a straight line on the ground, are your feet truly in line, or is your front foot forward of your back leg? Hop it back, get them in line, throw the hips back, right? Push, push, five, four, three, two, come up. Shift to the other side. Test the water. How far does your stride need to be? I'm always coming back to What's the relevance? Are you going to find yourself in this position at any point in your day? How does someone like me, my stride is increasing, present movements that are relative to you? And this one's a tricky one. Now, I know where this one comes into my life, because if you've ever seen me have to navigate getting on and off the boat, stepping on and off the boat, from the boat to the dinghy, from different boats to different dock heights, hold your push, then you'd be like, oh, well, she really needs to do that one because that's like a movement she gets into a lot. What is this knee doing? Where are your feet in relation to being on that straight line? Push the knee open, settle the hips. Your spine is long, no round in your spine, right? You want to lengthen, drive the derriere, and then you're going to take your knee. You're not going to let it collapse all the way because that's too much. Open it up and just let it float like you're doing this little partial clamshell, but really important, from your navel to right under your bust, extend, right? And now push it out, 5, 4, 3, 2. We're going to be release and relax. We're going to be doing a second set of that, but with a band and doing our little like sidewalks that we haven't done in forever. I want you to think aerobics. So just for the sake of, since I have a new little gadget, I'm going to put mine into the equation and I'm going to twist for about 30 to 45 seconds. If you want to grab your hula hoop, if you just want to be in prance mode for those 30, 45 seconds, maybe you've got your imaginary jump rope and you want to just like, you know, do that. What was the most fascinating thing for me about getting this little gadget is when I used to go to the gym with my mom when I was just a little girl, the machine that I guess intrigued me and captivated my attention the most was the machine that had this on it, and it had a post and handles. So imagine this little circle thing being a little bit bigger, but having a fixed post and handles on it. So I would step on the little disc. This is me as like, you know, a six-year-old, right? And I would just twist away. So I lose track of time when I'm doing things that are fun, right? So if you're in your jump rope, that might not be so fun, right? If you're jogging in place and you're getting bored, then maybe just add little hops, but I'm going to do about 10 more of these. Sadly, unless you were in like sock feet and on hardwood floor, if you were in sock feet, release and relax. If you were in sock feet on a hardwood floor, you probably could do the twisting, which would be a great little workout. So, you know me, I'm always trying to give you suggestions, things to do. Grab your lightweights. All right. What can we do with weights with a slightly bum shoulder? So, Peggy and Marlene, and any of the rest of us, even if you don't have shoulder glitch going on, we're going to do a little rotator cuff move. And so I need for you to grab a fairly small pillow, or like for me, I've got a big beach towel. This might be a little too wide. It's got too much width to it. So you're looking for a pillow or a little towel. And Marlene, you have done this with me like hundreds of times at the gym. For Marlene and I would roll up a little like a workout towel, you know, like your little kitchen towel, but in the gym, their workout towels. And we roll that thing up, stick it between the elbow and the body. So you could do both at the same time if you had two pillows. So you only need one of your weights. I want you to remember that when I teach class, I don't have a pre-scripted set of exercises we're doing. So there's an organic nature to it. And sometimes, you know, what it looks like you're going to do by the time you actually end up getting there to do it, it's morphed into something else. So if we're protecting our shoulder, the pillow will allow you to see a lot more about what your body generally does wrong. We don't want the pillow to be floating in and out. The pillow is used as an anchor to get your depressors and retractor stable so that when you execute your rotator cuff move, your arm can't slide. Right? So often when we move our arm, the elbow is sliding forward and back. And so our stabilizers are not working right. So roll up, put the pillow between your body and the inside of that arm, drop the shoulders. The arm is at a clean 90. Okay. And when you open the arm, you're trying to make the movement as stable as you can. Do you need to stand in one place? No. If you have a mirror, go put yourself in front of your mirror. If you're like, okay, I'm standing in front of my mirror, what am I supposed to be looking at? You want to make sure that your shoulders aren't piking up as the arm is moving and that you're not swinging the pillow. Okay. So now the next term is called time under tension. And what I want you to do is open the arm out to a loaded position, draw the shoulders down, zip up. Right. And so that arm is just in an active load. That's going to stay stationary. Your legs, however, are going into their little tick-tocks. We're not going to stay in tick-tock for long. This is the initial phase to get you ready for hip extension, pushback. So this arm, if it's starting to cheat and come back into forward position, open it back up, anchor your scapulas, right? Try to push the elbow down towards the hip, drive the heel back, zip up through the belly. There we go. Five more. Four, three. Your buns should be tight. Two, release and relax. Move the weight, move the pillow or the towel. Put yourself back in front of your mirror. If you walked away from it, shoulders down, turn yourself to the side. Where's your elbow? Set it under the shoulder, right? Start with the moving. We can do this. We can move side to side, right? Pull the arm in, pull the arm open, pull the arm in, activate. Everything releases, activate. Right? You're like, but we're doing something different with our leg than we did on the first arm. That's right, because it doesn't all have to be the same. Pull. You're getting ready to hold your arm open. Keep your step touch. Keep gliding the shoulders down. Use the inside of your elbow to push against the pillow or your towel. And now, hip extension. With your hip extension, right? The rest of your body stays nice and cleanly tensioned. It took me years to, and it sounds silly, right? Because the word tension, why would it take that long for me to figure out what one word means so much? Create the tension along your back body so that those muscles are in command of firing, right? You got about five more. Don't let that arm close in. You can always take the weight away if the weight's too much. Anchor the shoulder blades, belly to spine, zip up. You've got buns tight. Your shoulder blades can't release and relax. We can't just pull our shoulders back. This is really interesting. Set the lightweight down. Set your pillow down. You're going to get your feet moving again. You decide hula hoop, imaginary jump rope, marching feet, prancing around in your space. I'm going to go back to my core twister because I want to feel like I'm in play mode. Another little round here, trying to get your heart rate up a little bit. Squeeze the knees. Right? So if you're doing your hula hoop, squeeze your knees. So yesterday I'm at the pickleball court. I'm actually having to focus on this a little bit. Something like this little gadget tells me that I have more strength on one side of my oblique wall than I do the other. Because when I end up cockeyed around here, that means I'm driving. If I'm able to make a circle around in this like that, that means half of my muscle structure isn't working. Because both sides needing to work would keep me, or both sides working evenly would keep me directly lined up to the front. Wow. There's a thought. So now I'm just going to go and not worry about if I end up going around in a circle. And I've just increased my tempo. So whatever you're doing, try to increase your tempo a little bit, right? If you're doing the hula hoop, make it go the other way. If you're jogging in place, pick a different movement. So yesterday I'm at the pickleball court. Someone's talking to me about what it is that I do. Release and relax. And of course, you know, in my description, it's like rehab based stuff. And I said, I'm genuinely interested in why, when people have an injury and they go in for their rehab, why once they get released from rehab, they often do not continue to follow through with their rehab-based exercises. And these were two men I was speaking to, and they looked at me, and then they looked at each other because they both had different injuries that they've worked through, and they had that moment. I could tell. They were like, oh, like that makes perfect sense. So I said, that's the nature. You're just doing bicep curls. Remember when you were holding your pillow, right, with your elbow so your shoulder couldn't do the wrong thing? Put your imaginary pillows by your elbows. You're trying really hard to not slide your elbows forward and back, especially on the up. Okay, so anchor it. The great thing about this is called bilateral. The great thing about bilateral movement is that if you have an injury, only work the side that is not triggering pain. Okay, squeeze your buns. So then I proceeded to explain about my little Tuesday morning class and how I've come to do a class like that versus a boot camp class. And I said, I've just worked with so many people, release and relax your arms over the years and set your weights down, that have had, there's probably not an injury that I haven't been exposed to from a rehab-based position. Do you have your foam roller? Do you have a broomstick? Do you have a towel? Do you have anything that will allow you to do something like this with your arms? And so now, when you go into your overhead extension, you want to find the angle that doesn't trigger biting in your shoulder. We're not just going to do this. This gives us a focus for our arms. We're going to separate our feet like we're getting ready to do squats or deadlifts. You're going to keep your stick, your towel, your foam against your thighs. The arms are long and the arms are also tension loaded to keep active triceps. Look down at your feet. They're parallel to each other. I want you to squat pulling your hips back, sliding your object down. You're not putting your object in front of your knees. If your object comes ahead of your knees, you have gone too far. Stop right at the top of that thigh, just above the patella. That's your anchored position, right? Reach the arms forward. With your arms reaching forward, if your head is up and you're staring at the screen and you go to raise your arms higher, you are collapsing your neck. So I want you to turn your body so that you're looking at the screen and viewing the class from a side body position. Stand up, squeeze your buns. When you squeeze your buns, try not to collapse the spine. Here we go. The legs bend, and simultaneously as your legs are bending, you're gliding down to the tops of the knees. And then you set your head to neutral, pull your belly in, forward, reach your arms to whatever position does not create pain. And the ideal stop zone would be with your arms elevated so that your biceps and ears align. Bring the arms down, stand up. You are working your erectors. Squeeze your buns. Glide down, squat. You're looking down at a neutral position. Extend the arms, exhaling. Bring the arms down, pull up, squeeze. That's three of five. Pull the buns up under, shoulders down. Glide, 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 glide. Pause. Neck is neutral. Full reach. Arms down. Stand up. Pinch your parts. Pinch. Shoulders down. Last one. Gliding, sliding, pausing. Suck the belly in. Push the arms. Down they go. Stand up. Release and relax. So I do not intend on using my chair. I'm going to use my foam roller. I know that I have really good flexibility with my hamstrings and my ability to have hip flexor strength to clear my foam. And if you're like, well, my chair is someplace else. Maybe your coffee table is right here and you're like, okay, I can get up and over my coffee table. Maybe you don't have to pull a chair into the equation. Maybe your ottoman is there. But what I want you to do, remember the rock step that we started with? That essentially is the rhythm. So test the water. Sweep the leg and go, oh, okay, there we go. And you're like, okay, I need to clear my object. How much time do you need to get up and around your object? Keeping in mind that when you lift your leg, if the rest of the body buckles, that's not good. Command your parts. This is like clean, precise. It is a sweep, lift, sweep, down, lift, sweep, down. I don't have to stay in one spot. Every time my foot comes down, I can do a few inches as I transition weight from right to left foot and move around my object, right? Push. Don't let yourself get too close to your object, right? You want it to be the foot that's coming over your object. Release, relax. Other side. Test the water. How does your balance feel? Can you find a little rhythm? Step back, lift the other leg. Forward swing, step back, lift the other leg. That's your rhythm. Instead of loading that front foot, right? That front foot gets to come up and over your object. Now, this is part of dynamic flexibility, okay? Because there's a power, there's an explosiveness to you getting the heavy leg up and over, up, over. Abs are tight. Every time that leg lifts